Well, good evening, everyone. Michael, soothing here. I thought tonight what we would chat about a little bit is the scourge of global warming and why you might not be perhaps too stressed out by it. Maybe I can bring you a little bit of soothing, relaxing commentary on the issue so that you won't be so panicked about the effects of the CO2 that we are adding to the atmosphere. Now, the approach I want to take on this topic will be not an approach based on politics, not an approach based on alarmists versus skeptics, not an approach based on believers versus deniers, not an approach that says there is no global warming, or man doesn't contribute, or it's a terrible catastrophe that's going to wipe out the planet. I'm going to take just more of a scientific data approach because I've been following this topic for about 15 years, reading about 20 some plus websites that have actual data and are tracking data on the topic. So I want to talk to you about things like, what is the actual increase or not in sea level rise over the last few years and decades? How about Arctic ice or temperatures or things along those lines? I think this debate on global warming should be about the science and not about politics before we rush to make too many radical decisions on the best approach to solve the problem. Now, of course, it would take probably 20 or 30 hours of rambling to thoroughly discuss and dissect all the nuances of this topic, at least. So I'm really just going to ramble and skim the surface a little bit. And with you, I will look at a few web pages that have some data. Not editorial pages by people that are true believers or true skeptics of global warming, but mostly we'll look at pages of data that are produced by the National Oceanographic, NOAA of America, that guy, ISS, NASA, and so forth. Let's go take a peek at the computer monitor and do a little rambling on some of these topics and see what we can find out together. Here is a shot of the live chill map, which shows, using my electronic pointer here, my high-tech electronic pointer, that other than a little bit of the southwest here, which is normal, the rest of the country is frigidly cold. As you can see, most of the country here, possibility of snow if it hasn't happened already, even down in parts of Florida. So I feel bad for all the folks east of the Rockies in particular. You can see in the live chill map a lot of minuses here. Minus 15, minus 12, minus 7, minus 15. When you get up into Canada, you're dropping in minus 30 and that kind of thing. So mighty frigid for you folks there on the East Coast. I'm wondering if the Great Lakes will freeze over this year again, as they have in the past few years several times, which is very unusual when you look back over history. It just happens once in a while. I'm guessing that Lake Superior and Lake Michigan and Ontario may very well freeze over. We'll see what happens when we get to February or March or so. So I find this interesting. A lot of cold weather records are being broken over the last few days. But that lines up with what's been happening for the last few years, because over the last decade, far more cold weather records have been broken at monitoring stations in the U.S. than hot weather records, believe it or not. There's an imbalance, though you wouldn't know it from just watching media reports most of the time. You have to actually go into the meteorological data to find this out. And, of course, to find out a lot of other things, such as what's actually happening with actual measured data when it comes to sea level rise. So I thought you might want to... All right, since I'm away from home at the moment, I have to do this funky laptop shot to show you what's going on in the country. Mount Washington is among the coldest places on the planet, and beyond Mount Washington's summit. Let's see how cold it is there right now. Mount Washington Observatory in New Hampshire isn't just cold at minus 36 degrees with a wind chill of 94 below zero. It is tied for the second coldest place on Earth, according to a tweet from the observatory. This is just one of the many things going on at the moment that shows that the East Coast of the United States is in really quite a deep freeze mode. Well, before we zoom in on the computer, would it be so bad if the world looked more like this, your world? I don't know. Anyway, before we zoom in and start looking at some of the charts and graphs and other things related to global warming, I thought I would start by looking at the boogeyman, or the foundational culprit for the current global warming theory put forth by the IPCC and others. And that boogeyman would be the trace gas known, of course, as carbon dioxide, or CO2. First of all, let's talk a little bit. And why is it a boogeyman? Well, because, let's show you, for, say, a few thousand years, carbon dioxide in the atmosphere was between something like 250 to 300 parts per million. And then over the last 100 years or so, since the industrial age began, carbon dioxide has climbed to almost 400 parts per million. And in the last few decades, temperatures globally have climbed about 0.8 of a degree. So some scientists draw a strong correlation between that carbon dioxide increase and global temperatures. Let's take a look on a chart and see what we're talking about. Maybe I can put you to sleep with this chart. Anyway, what we see here is we start with the year 1900 down here. And if we consider that our baseline and say that that zero point is about 280 parts per million of CO2, we have climbed. Here's the CO2 increase. In red, we have climbed about 80 some parts per million since then. All right? So, you know, we've gone from, like I said, about 280 to about 380 parts per million. Now, almost 400 parts per million. It varies a little bit, even during the year, you know, climbing in the winter and dropping as we head towards summer and things like that. When we look at global temperatures, the temperature anomaly, it's called, we see that back in 1900, we went through a really strong warming phase here, culminating around 1940. And we weren't putting out a lot of CO2 during that time, however, but the temperature anomaly climbed by about half a degree. Then it went into a cooling pattern for the next few decades up until, if we average it, it went into a cooling phase up until about 1980 or so. And in fact, when I was in high school and college, all the talk amongst scientists was global cooling, that man-made emissions were causing a coming ice age. You can Google this and go back to Time magazine covers and Newsweek covers back in the 1970s, for example, about the man-caused coming ice age. They supposedly had a consensus of scientists back then too. And that's because they were looking at temperature data going back to the 1930s through the 1970s and said, oh no, man is causing the globe to cool. We're going to have an ice age again. So, since then, however, as you can see, there's been a pretty strong warming trend from about 1980 up and through about the year 2000. Big strong warming trend there, as you can see. But what's happened since then? We've actually had a period of temperature stasis over the last 15 years or so, in spite of the headlines you read that say, we've had some of the warmest years ever, da-da-da. That's true, because we're up at the high end of this graph now, aren't we? However, temperatures haven't climbed substantively for the last 15 years or so. It's called the pause in some scientific literature, and it's difficult for science to explain. But where does this kind of stuff lead us? There are a couple theories about the temperature. Wait, let me see if I can shoot a thumbnail right here. Let's try that again. See, I don't want you to be too panicked about warming, because some things we can do, but this isn't a catastrophe looming over our heads in the near future, in my humble opinion. Anyway, is there a correlation between CO2 and warming temperatures? It would appear so. But many other questions then arise. How much of this increased CO2 is due to man-made activity? Well, some theories show that historical data indicates strongly that the globe goes in warming and cooling cycles, and that every time you go into a warming trend, the ocean gets larger, it swells up because warmer water expands, of course, and as it expands, it also releases massive gigatons of CO2 into the atmosphere. So some scientists would say the warming comes first and then the CO2 increase. I'm not sure I buy that theory, but there are differences of opinion on this. When you look back on the scientific record, going back millions of years and doing ice core analyses and things, that does seem to be the case. However, we do know that there is a correlation with CO2 and warming, so we should be commensurately concerned enough to do what we can to make efficient use of our fossil fuel resources and not waste a lot of it, but at the same time not bankrupt ourselves in the process. Because think for a moment about some of the implications. The globe has warmed about 7-8 tenths of a degree in 100 years. But there have been other times in the last few thousand years when the same thing happened, and it wasn't catastrophic. What was catastrophic was when we went into cooling trends and a mini ice age. That was a bad thing because it resulted in crop failures, mass starvation, plague, and millions of deaths. Much more so than a warming planet, a cooling planet would be deadly for many species. You know, the biomass of the Earth was much more vast and healthier back during the, you know, the Cretaceous period and the age of dinosaurs. At that time, the Earth was warmer than it is today. So we have to keep this in mind. If you have increased CO2 and a little bit of warming with it, what you have overall is longer growing seasons, a much larger biomass, because plants thrive on CO2. CO2 is the building block of life. It's not a pollutant, as you may have heard from the EPA a few years back. CO2 is what plants live on. It's what allows all life to exist, because we start with the herbivores, right, who eat the plants, and including us, because we eat quite a bit of, well, we can be vegan if we want to. We can eat soy and corn and vegetables and fruit. It's quite critical. If we had far less CO2, we'd all be starving. So we have to keep this in mind. It's not a pollutant. We are carbon-based mammals. And So are the rest of the mammals, I might add. You know that even if you don't know science, you've seen, you know, Star Trek or something. And so we shouldn't have too much hysteria about CO2, the boogeyman, but we should look at the scientific data and see whether there are judicious actions we can take as a species without causing mass starvation or hardship, if there are things we can do that are intelligent, right? To not be wasteful. So I don't want to say that there's no global warming, for example, because there is. The globe has been warming since the last ice age, as I mentioned before, and at some point it's going to reverse and we're going to have another ice age if the world lasts long enough. But let's look at some of the, by the way, the reason I'm now dressed nice and warm and have my tropical background is because I decided to turn the heat up in my house because I remembered that my power here on the Oregon coast comes from hydropower, which is quite clean. It's the Bonneville Dam over on the Columbia River that provides much of Northwest Oregon with its power. Not many places in the country are fortunate enough to have such a power source as that. So, but it's kind of nice. It also means lower electric bills. So most homes here are powered by just electricity. No natural gas or anything. No heating oil. And that's rather convenient, really, in a way. But anyway, let's move on. And for you folks freezing on the East Coast, by the way, relief is in sight because there's a warming trend coming soon. But before we do that, I'm always forgetting critical things I wanted to mention. Some people don't think in terms of math and science. And so when we talk about CO2 levels being going from roughly 300 parts per million in the atmosphere to 400 parts per million, I just want to make sure you understand what that means. It means that CO2 concentration in the atmosphere is less than 1/1000th of the atmosphere. Far less. It is a trace gas. It is currently about 0.4 of 1000th. Okay? So it's not as if there's a lot of it. And, you know, most of the atmosphere is nitrogen, which is an inert gas. And then we have, of course, oxygen, which is quite important for us. And then we have other constituents like hydrogen and some real greenhouse gases like methane. But the most important greenhouse gas is water vapor. That's about 95% of the effect when it comes to retaining warmth in the Earth's atmosphere. So it can be grossly overstated. Do you hear that frog in the background? I hear a frog. Anyway, keep the CO2 in perspective. It's a tiny fly speck. Trace gas, and it may be overstated as to its importance as a greenhouse gas. Just food for thought. But I'm going to give you some resources in links below to check out if you really want to delve more into this issue at the end of this video, if you're not already asleep, which I hope you will be, okay, because then you won't be stressing about the topic so much. Moving on to a few webpage perusals now in a low-tech fashion. Let's get rid of our lovely photo of the future where we're going to live and instead look at some of the things going on that we can discuss. Why don't we start with how things are looking right now on the East Coast? Would you rather have the scene we were just looking at, or would you rather have this? It's just something to keep in mind as we look at a few of these photos. Where is this? Cleveland. Remember that we had predictions a few years ago from global warming alarmists and the IPCC reports that are done by that International Panel on Climate Change, saying that the era of snow and ice in the Northern Hemisphere was over. We just weren't going to have snowy, cold winters anymore. Is that in fact the case in your experience over the last few years? If you live, say, in the Northeast, where the Great Lakes have frozen over several times in the last decade, you know, where I lived in Santa Cruz, I remember trying to get ice like this off my windshield last year in Oregon. It's very unusual in Oregon for it to be like this if you're by the coast. But we had serious snow, the most serious snow in quite a long time. So is the era of cold, snowy winters gone? Will children never see snow again, as was predicted 10 years ago? It would not seem so far, you know, judging by how things have been going. And by the way, more cold temperature records have been broken in the last 10 years than hot, believe it or not. Or maybe we have to go back 20 years for that in the United States. All right, so we'll get rid of this one and take a look at Arctic sea ice. We had another prediction by scientists and the IPCC that sea ice would be all gone in the Arctic. And by now, you know, they were saying 20 years ago, oh, there just won't be sea ice up there anymore. It will all melt. Let's take a look at the daily image and see if that is in fact the case. If we go back to historic norms of sea ice prior to the current warming we've had since 1980, the sea ice extent was out to this brown line here, see? And so you can see we do have less sea ice in several places than you have relative to that 1980 to 2000 average median point. But there are still a healthy ice cap up in the Arctic. Down in the Antarctic, we need to keep in mind that the ice cap there is much larger in mass than the Arctic North Pole. At the South Pole, the ice cap is got about 50% more mass as to ice. And it was reaching record highs 3 or 4 years ago. There was more ice gained in the Antarctic than was lost in the Arctic. Now this year, it's a little different. The Antarctic is lower than it was a couple years ago, but I'm just giving you examples of how it can vary and how we're not certainly at a panicky point at this point. All right? So there's that. How about the very important issue of, by the way, these images are from the National Snow and Ice Data Center. This is government science run website that tracks. They're a highly pro global warming catastrophe organization, because their funding, of course, is based on making sure that this will be a crisis. So when you hear about some of the scientists who are making catastrophic predictions, it's often because in some ways their funding is based on this. I would like to see science done objectively, where we're not pro-global warming and we're not anti-global warming, we're just pro-science. What is the data really telling us? You know, again, I remember when they said we were headed for an ice age back when I was in school. It seems they were incorrect about that. Things vary. Let's take a look at the next issue, which is sea level rise. Once again, this is not a website that's trying to convince you of anything. This is data from the National Oceanic Atmospheric Administration, NOAA, and it's giving us sea level trends to show how much sea level is rising around the world. Right now we're focused on North American continent. Now, you may have heard that if you saw that movie, An Inconvenient Truth, or read some of the International Panel on Climate Change reports that came out 5 or 10 or 15 or 20 years ago, that sea level rise from melting glaciers and ice caps was catastrophic, and the oceans were rising like mad at an increasing rate, and soon they'd be 10 or 20 feet higher. They would be swallowing up New York City and things like that. So the question we would like to ask, looking at the actual government measured data from sea level tracking stations, is in fact the sea level going through a catastrophic increase in its rate of rise? Well, to answer that question, let's look at some of the actual data. We heard that Indian tribes, for example, were being run off some of their lands up around Alaska in island areas and things because of global warming. You can go back and search those stories. But if you look at the actual data, let's click on some of these spots and see what's happening. If we click this one, for example, Yakutat, Alaska, sea level has been dropping 14 millimeters per year. Wow. From 1988 through 2016. That's the equivalent to a change of a 5 foot drop over 100 years. My goodness. So apparently sea level isn't rising everywhere. Now, of course, it's not so much there that the ocean has dropped in level. It's more that the land is bouncing back up like a spring after being released from the weight of a massive amount of hundreds of feet of ice that were sitting on top of it during the last ice age. So that's part of the reason, it's the elasticity of the land. But if we look at several spots along the shore of Alaska, Kodiak Island is a sea level drop 10 millimeters per year, okay? What about along, well, let's take the worst examples of sea level increase. The most increase we are seeing is along the Gulf Coast, like Freeport, Louisiana, or Texas. Their sea level is going up about 4.4 millimeters a year. That would equal 1.5 feet over the next 100 years, a 1.5 foot rise. How about these red arrows? That would be the worst case. Here, Grand Isle, Louisiana is gaining 9 millimeters per year. That would equal a 3 foot increase in 100 years. Now, mind you, that has to do with, as you can see, very localized conditions in the Gulf Coast. And that can also be partly attributed to land dropping. But what about the median? What's really happening overall? Well, overall, the sea level had been going up since the last ice age at roughly anywhere from 2 to 4 millimeters per year overall on average throughout the globe for quite an a loud sound outside caused me to have to restate that overall sea level has been increasing about 2 to 5 millimeters per year for some time now. And of course, that's been happening since the last ice age 10,000 years ago. Of course, it has varied along the way because there's been many warm period. There's been like the medieval warm period about 1,000 years ago. Sea level was rising faster then. And there have been the mini ice age along the way where it was rising slower. But on balance, if you go back, say, 100 years before mankind and humanity was putting anthropogenic CO2 into the atmosphere, sea level has been rising about 3 millimeters per year. Is that drastically increased now today, now that we're putting additional CO2 into the atmosphere? The answer would appear to be no, because the sea is still going up about 3 millimeters per year. Now, what does 3 millimeters a year equate to? Well, what it equates to is that you would get roughly 1 inch of sea level rise over, it's really right now about 2.5 millimeters. And so you would get about an inch of sea level rise in most regions over a 10-year period, or you could say about a foot of sea level rise over the next 100 years. But remember, the catastrophic science predictions you've been hearing about are like 20 feet of sea level rise. They're overstating the issue by about 20 times, you know, about 2,000%. So maybe we shouldn't get quite as worked up about it. Over 100 years' time, you can easily compensate for a 1 foot rise in sea level by making some minor adjustments. We can look at a few of these sample spots, like here along the Oregon coast, for example, Port Orford. How are we doing on the Oregon coast? We are going up in sea level by 0.0 millimeters per year, 1977 through 2016. Does that sound like a catastrophe to you on the Oregon coast? I don't think so. What about down in California? I spent 50 years in the Santa Cruz area, and there was virtually no sea level rise at the tide and measurement gauges there. None. There are a couple places you drive right by the high tide line on Highway 1, down in Moss Landing, for example. There's a tidal estuary that comes right up to the road, and it's been coming right up to the same spot every year since I was a kid. No increase whatsoever. So if we look at Europe, same thing. You know, here's the UK, Dublin, Ireland, 0.07 millimeters per year sea level rise currently. That's less than 0.02 of a foot in 100 years. Does that sound like a catastrophe to you? Something we should panic about? Not in our lifetime. Even if we go down to South America, we're going to see the same things. Look down here at Patagonia, down close to the southern, the Antarctic ice cap. Let's click on this one. Puerto de Suado, Argentina. The sea is actually dropping in sea level down there. All right. So I hope you can see. Once again, I'll link this for you down below the video so that you can see that what you hear in the popular media is extremely and drastically overstated compared to the actual measured data. This is the same thing you will find when you're looking at the temperature data for the atmosphere as well. What do I have next here? Oh, look, snow in the Sahara Desert. This is from the last couple days, okay? And there's a series of images. This would have been unthinkable according to the predictions that we heard about the sub-Saharan desert a few years ago by global warming alarmists. What else? What are some other topics we can talk about? If you want to go to a website that will show you a lot of interesting sort of climate 101 type stuff with reference pages, the biggest go-to site, the one that gets the most views, like here's an article on whether there are extreme weather events are based on global warming. You know, we had some extreme hurricanes this year in the Caribbean, and we had fires in Southern California going right into December that are finally being put out by rain. Those would be extreme events, but are they being caused by global warming? Well, if you go back in California's history, you'll see that these kinds of fires have occurred throughout the history of California. And if you look at hurricane activity in the Gulf Coast and Caribbean, you'll see that we went through about 15 years of the quietest hurricane seasons in recorded memory before this bad season came. So when you look at actual data, we don't see any correlation to extreme events versus global warming. But anyway, this site, Anthony Watt's site, WUWT, has a lot of reference pages and interesting information. For example, you can go to the reference pages and you can look at charts and graphs on the atmospheric temperature or climate phenomena, geomagnetism, global temperature anomaly, oceanic data, sea ice page, etc., etc. I will link it below because, like, if we go to the CO2 page, for example, you can see all kinds of data here. CO2 measurements at Mauna Loa in Hawaii by the NOAA, the National Oceanic Administration, Atmospheric Administration. Okay, recent global monthly CO2, you'll find a graph for that. You can see how it varies from year to year in an oscillating pattern, but it is an uptrend in CO2, of course. All right, we're back once again. Boy, this is going to be a long video, but it's still only 1/100th of what we could discuss. Here we have, anyway, chart after chart of showing actual data and then discussing that data. Here we have CO2 increase from 1970 through the present in parts per million. Okay, so this is a very excellent site when it comes to reference data and a discussion of it, what it might mean. One thing to keep in mind, you've heard that all scientists, or 97% of scientists, agree that man is causing, or the primary cause of global warming. I think if you start studying the actual information on it, you'll find that's not the case. It's like because the scientists who reach that consensus are the ones who are getting paid to make those kind of statements in grant money. But if you look at atmospheric, meteorological, and climate scientists overall who are objective and not being paid to say such things, there is not that consensus. Somewhere here, I believe I have, yes. The Global Warming Petition Project, for example, 31,400 something American scientists have signed this petition, including over 9,000 with PhDs, and the petition says, we don't agree that man is the primary cause of global warming because the data doesn't really show that. Most of them would say, we agree that we're adding CO2 to the atmosphere and that it has an impact on global warming, but is not the primary cause. There are other natural causes that have to do with things like Pacific Decadal Oscillation, which I won't get into, the sun, the actual sun's output variation, solar variation, I won't get into that either, but that varies. Those are some of the things we could be discussing. And we know that some of the leading global warming catastrophe proponents, such as Michael Mann, here's a site called Hide the Decline. That's because when there's declining temperatures being recorded by stations, or declining temperatures that happened in the past, there is a group of scientists, you've heard of ClimateGate, or you could look it up on Google, James Hansen and people like that, Michael Mann, and their internal memos and things to each other were how they could fudge the data. So that's a problem when it comes to science. We should never fudge the data. I will bookmark some of these sites. Well, here's an interesting thing to look at, for example, polar bears. You know that polar bears were the poster animal for catastrophic climate change and global warming. But the experts, like this particular scientist, Susan Crockford, are saying that polar bears are healthier than ever. They are looking at actual populations and the health of these polar bears. And climate scientists who are blowing the bugle for catastrophe are very unhappy that polar bears are thriving because they were the poster child for extinction due to global warming, and instead they're thriving. So it says here, polar bear experts who falsely predicted that 17,000 something polar bears would be dead by now, given sea ice conditions, have realized their failed prediction has not only kicked their credibility to the curb, but it has taken with it the reputation of their climate change colleagues. The scientists who study polar bears were actually disinvited to the last IPCC conference because they did not want actual data or actual facts about current polar bear populations and health to be even mentioned, since it didn't fit their agenda and narrative. That's a problem with science when it comes to saying we should be able to discuss all the facts, both pro and con. I think when it comes to global warming, we need to be given all the facts and all the data before we take drastic action. Not just half, not just the half that supports one position. And what you'll find is, with many of the scientists, so-called, who are getting massive grant money to come up with a certain result, every time they revise their climate models, when the predictions fail, as they have been for decades now, when their drastic predictions fail to come to pass by the year 2000 or 2005 or 2010 or 2015 or 2020, what they do is they go back and they revise the data to make the past look colder and make the present look hotter. But that's not science. That's actually fraud. So we don't really want to take that approach. I think the globe is warming over the long trend, and I think mankind is contributing to that to some degree. The question is how much? What do we do about it? And is it really so horrible if we're half a degree warmer than we 100 years from now, all right? Popular technology. 1,350 plus peer-reviewed scientific papers support skeptic arguments against anthropogenic global warming alarmism. I will bookmark, I will link some of these. We looked at the Arctic chill already. Other causes that can lead to global warming or cooling include the variation in solar output, which goes in cycles, 7-year cycles and longer cycles. And that is tied to sunspots and activity in the sun, which you can see right now is very quiet. Normally, you see sunspots, but the current image shows no sunspots. That's a little bit of a concern because it means the sun's output is lower than normal. And we could have cooling over the next few decades. It's possible. Right now, temps are flat. We should all hope that we don't go into a cooling or ice age trend. That would be the real catastrophe. We looked at this already. There's a page about CO2. Here's an oceanic oscillation page that shows how the ocean goes in decadal patterns over the last few hundred years that also affect temperatures and how much CO2 is released from the oceans as they warm and cool. So I think this is a long enough ramble for now to show you that maybe we shouldn't panic just yet. Maybe we can relax a little, take a deep breath, and look at this objectively, this whole issue, before we say the sky is okay. I think in summary, I would just say a few of the following things. Firstly, I think over the long run, the globe is warming. That's what the data indicates. I think that CO2 has an effect on this warming, although that effect may be overstated, since CO2 is a very minor trace gas as far as greenhouse effect relative to, say, water vapor, methane, and other things. and based on the historical record, but there does seem to be a correlation. I think we should try to conserve and be judicious with fossil fuels, but not at the expense of bankrupting the poor and middle class of the world. I don't think running our utility bill up to $1,000 a month and sending that money to Washington will solve much. But that's a political question, and I don't want to talk politics in this video. However, you know, we should continue to study the real science of this. I am concerned that science has become prejudicial and non-objective on this topic and is based more on an agenda and a narrative and a desire to get millions of dollars in grant money than being based on falsifiable theories and actual data collection and predictions that can either be falsified or shown to be accurate. All the wild predictions made by the so-called consensus of scientists in the IPCC reports of the last 2.5 decades have proven to be grossly incorrect. So I think we need to do a better job of being objective. And also the scientists who are at the top of this particular alarmism campaign have been shown, why is my stomach making funny noises? Have been shown so far to be less than objective when they change their data constantly, including historical data, in order to achieve a desired result. If the satellite data, which is the most accurate, is not reflecting what they want, then they revert to things like proxy data. You know, there's a whole climate gate scandal related to substituting good data, wintertime voice trouble, with, say, tree ring data. Just look up tree ring proxy and climate gate and hide the decline. For some examples, look them up on the links I provided. I am not a skeptic as to whether global warming is occurring, and I'm not a skeptic as to whether sea levels are rising. I'm not a skeptic as to whether CO2 has gone up from man-made activity, and I'm not a skeptic as to whether that has some influence on global temperatures and climate. What I am a skeptic about is as to whether it is a catastrophe, and I think that we can relax on that front. If the last few decades are any indication of what's actually happening versus what the alarmists said would happen, with, for example, an acceleration in sea level rise, which we simply are not seeing, okay? It is rising a tiny, tiny, almost immeasurable amount every year that would equate to about an inch or so or less every 10 years or a foot every 100 years, but we were already rising at that rate prior to the Industrial Revolution. these are the kinds of things we need to step back from and say, let's look at the facts from both sides. And if the globe is warming a tiny bit, is that necessarily so horrible for mankind on balance? It will create some problems in coastal cities 100 years from now when you and I are all long gone. But are those problems insurmountable compared to the real catastrophe that would occur if the globe was cooling and we were all faced with mass starvation and extinction, including many other species besides our own? If plant life was being strangled by a lack of CO2, which is, you know, essential to their life and greening of the planet, is a little more CO2 so bad when it has resulted in better, faster diversity of the biomass when it comes to the flora of the earth, all of the green plants and trees and so forth, since we were deforesting quite a bit of it? Now that is growing back fast. Here in Oregon, for example, I can tell you, where we grow most of the trees for the United States, the lumber industry, but they grow back faster than they can practically harvest them. All right, so anyway, this isn't meant to be pro or anti global warming. It's meant to put your mind at ease a little bit. This is not a crisis for you or your children compared to many other dangers in the world that are far more frightening that you should think about and try to resolve. So it's a back burner issue, but of course we should be careful with our resources and continue when it makes good economic sense to build out solar power and wind power, geothermal power, and so forth, but not at the expense of taking trillions of dollars from poor and middle class people and raising their gas and their heating bills to astronomically high levels, you know. So that's my my sort of moderation take on it, and I hope that this video relaxed you a little bit on the topic, and that you can rest easy a little bit and not worry quite so much if it was bothering you. All right, or maybe it will spur your curiosity to do a little pro-con research on the topic, as I have.